Welcome, everybody. I'm Gailyn Saroyan. I want to thank the Cultural Affairs Committee for organizing this event and for asking me to speak this evening. I also want to thank Stephen Keelan for creating the beautiful PowerPoint that will accompany this talk. I've lived here at the Green for the past 16 years. From the beginning of our life here, I started to study the history of our community. Part of what got me intrigued was that during our first year here, Village Green was designated a National Historic Landmark, vaulting it into the top tier of historically important places in the whole country. A few years and a lot of volunteer work later, Village Green again made history when it became the first condo community to be accepted into the Mills Act program, a privilege which grants us significant yearly tax breaks. To continue to get this benefit, we're asked to honor the historically significant elements of our architectural and landscaping design. Tonight, we're gathered here to celebrate Village Green's 75th anniversary. Actually, we're a few days late, since as fate would have it, the official opening turned out to be Pearl Harbor Day, December 7th, 1941. There's a poignant story about the Green as the war years were finally ending, told by one of our first residents, a teacher named Helen Spears. Quote, "Often we stand and just look out at the Green through the large front windows. It refreshes the spirit, calms the inner upheavals brought on by the impact of war news, rests the eyes, and brings a fleeting calm to jangled nerves. Today, we were jolted by the sight of two horses, manes and tails flying, running full gallop down the length of the green, unbridled and unattended. Where have they come from? And where are they going?" Unquote. So, just how did this almost magical place happen? The design of our community is the result of the passion and dedication of a group of people at the top of their professions in the fields of urban planning, architecture, and landscape architecture. An important, but not the only, impetus for its creation was provided by the capitalist catastrophe of the Great Depression. But the kind of well-thought-out design we're both the beneficiaries and the stewards of didn't just spring up overnight in response to that immediate crisis. Village Green was inspired by the early 20th century Garden City movement. Many say we're the finest example of a garden city in the United States. The Garden City movement had been founded in England by a quietly charismatic man named Ebenezer Howard. Oddly enough, it was an American book, a runaway international bestseller called Looking Backward, 2000 to 1887, written by the novelist and journalist Edward Bellamy, that catalyzed Howard into action. Published in 1888, this remarkable book predicted the invention of the airplane, of radio and television, the internet, Amazon, even Amazon Prime, as well as Garden City-like neighborhoods, designed to house a population liberated from the class system by a supremely rational, bloodless revolution. By the way, you can now download this book for free on Kindle, which is quite a trip of its own. Ebenezer Howard was a man from humble beginnings who rose to champion the building of the first garden cities in England. In a radical departure within Britain's rigid class system, these garden cities were owned in common by all their residents, much like us now at Village Green. Howard's dream was to create communities that would combine the best aspects of the city with the best aspects of the country. The marketing slogan for garden cities built in urban areas was that they would create, quote, the country in the city, unquote. And in more rural areas, they would, conversely, be more like, quote, the city in the country, unquote. The year before he died, Ebenezer Howard, a stenographer and inventor by trade, the son of a London baker, was knighted by the King of England for his service to his nation. When he died, his friend Bernard Shaw said that if all the articles about him at his death were lined up side by side, it would have stretched around the world. One of the distinctions of our garden city here at Village Green is that we were designed by a team under the strong leadership of the most distinguished architect ever to build a garden city in the United States. That man was Reginald Davis Johnson. Before undertaking the design of our middle-class community, he was known as perhaps the premier architect in Southern California for lavish mansions, estates, and hotels of impeccable taste created for the social elite of the region. From the very beginning of his career, his projects earned a panoply of top honors from his peers. By the end of his career, he had won every honor a successful architect could hope for in a lifetime. On all of his projects, Johnson was dedicated to creating, quote-unquote, the whole picture. He had a strong understanding of how the effectiveness of his designs would be enhanced by a thorough integration of building and landscape, a principle especially appropriate in our region's enviable climate. This principle became one of the abiding signatures of his projects as he worked in close collaboration with the top landscape architects of his time. Another of Johnson's signatures was a concern with lifestyle pleasures. From the beginning, his work encouraged a more casual, more quote-unquote modern way of life for his wealthy clients. Renowned as a master of proportion, his unostentatious, elegantly gracious homes all shared an aura of classic calm. The serenity that infused all of his work, combined with a lifelong fascination with radical ideas and innovations. Like Thomas Jefferson, he could combine two disparate ideas reflecting radical and conservative outlooks in a way that led his admirers to consider him an artist among architects. In fact, some consider that Village Green rises to the level of a work of environmental art. Reginald Johnson came from a line of distinguished ancestors that included spiritual and educational leaders, senators, abolitionists, and suffragists. These were all people who held high social positions but were passionate about improving the lives of their fellow citizens. One of his earliest colonial ancestors is credited with developing the philosophy that led to the inclusion of the phrase "and the pursuit of happiness" into the Declaration of Independence. His civic-minded heritage, no doubt, spurred the young architect at the beginning of his career to hire and mentor, 50 years before the Civil Rights Act, the young African-American architect Paul Revere Williams, a brilliant tastemaker who went on to become the most famous African-American architect in history. Johnson himself became the first Southern California architect to win the highest honor at the national level from the prestigious American Institute of Architects for a residential work. And a few years later, it was Johnson who again broke this ceiling nationally, this time for a work of commercial architecture, the Biltmore Hotel in Santa Barbara. His design for the Biltmore, which in some ways predicts his work a decade later at Village Green, radically reconfigured the luxury hotel paradigm into a series of bungalows, laid out around central garden spaces, with in-house boutiques providing services for hotel guests. In effect, it was really a sort of garden city for rich vacationers. The artistry with which it catalyzed quote-unquote lifestyle into the hotel environment stunned the architectural world and keeps it on the list of legendary hotels to this day. When the Great Depression hit in 1929, even though Johnson was still in great demand by wealthy clients, he underwent a profound personal conversion to the cause of better housing for the wider population. In a posthumous tribute to him, it was said that now, quote, humanity became his client, unquote. He now worked tirelessly advocating for better designed public housing. A charming, but rather shy man, he pushed himself to give speeches, lobbying his wealthy friends and clients and the government to support bold new solutions to the nationwide housing crisis. As he launched into this new phase of his career, Johnson won the Presidential Gold Medal for the best small house in America, built in 1930. It was for his design of the gardener's cottage on an estate in Montecito, noted in its citation for its situation in, quote, a most fortunate setting, unquote, that Johnson trademark. The final commission he accepted before closing his private practice to begin his work on our community was for the main post office in Santa Barbara. He donated his services on the project and proceeded to design a post office that combined classic elegance with cutting-edge technology in its inner workings, and it became a national sensation. This descendant of a long line of civic leaders gave a speech at the opening festivities he titled, Your Post Office. And then, for the widest swath of the population, the middle class, Johnson embarked on the showcase design for a garden city in the most car-centric city in the country, originally called Thousand Gardens, then Baldwin Hills Village, and now known to us as Village Green. He hired as consulting architect an influential contemporary of his from the East Coast, Clarence Stein. As architects, the two men had both gone through rigorous Beaux-Arts training, Stein in Paris and Johnson at MIT. A difference between them was that Stein had also been trained, beginning in his reform-minded grade school, to be an architectural activist. He became the foremost champion of the Garden City movement in America, where he focused on adapting it to the rapidly accelerating motor age. In his apartment, high up in a building overlooking the sweep of Central Park in New York City, Stein brainstormed with a small but diverse group of think-outside-the-box people that included women, a philosopher, an economist, an architectural historian slash critic, and an ecologist. In order to create the radically common sense solutions for how they felt most people actually wanted to live, legend has it that Stein deployed this little group, like a regiment, to cut relentlessly through established rules and regulations. The vision for a more satisfying and sustainable lifestyle for America and the planet that Stein and his group of practical-minded idealists developed was a landscape dotted with regionally adapted garden city, quote-unquote, pods, of which Village Green is a prime example. The idea was that these pods would be connected by public transport and highways. Car use would naturally diminish as neighborly pleasures and a shared enjoyment of nature flourished. From the outset, one of the important signatures of these new communities was a dedication to sustainable, often native, landscaping. An idea far ahead of its time, they understood that its minimal maintenance requirements would help keep things affordable while still being beautiful. Clarence Stein is considered to be the most important urban planner of the 20th century, and it was his estimation that Village Green was the most successful example of his ideals ever built. Some of the elements here at Village Green that foster the neighborliness he wanted to encourage are the complete separation of pedestrian and vehicular pathways, achieved with the relegation of all cars to the periphery of a super block-sized property with no streets running through it, a landscape design of interior parkland with winding paths suitable for all ages, the calming effect of large areas of nature within an urban community, and the orienting of the main interior living spaces to vistas of nature. Another subtle but important element that I'd like to focus on here is the paint colors of the buildings and how they interacted with the landscape in a way that provided unity and harmony, yet still retained articulation of the architecture of Reginald Johnson. In particular, the buildings are painted in nature-inspired hues that play off the grounds as rich but simple plant textures and colors, and all of it exists in calming contrast to the smooth green panels of grass. Working with Garden City principles, our head architect Johnson worked to create an environment, this time for the middle class, that would foster a luxuriously relaxed lifestyle reminiscent of what he so successfully created for his wealthy clients with their unlimited budgets. When you think about it, he used his skills to quote-unquote democratize the lifestyle of his wealthy clients, and now he elevated the quality of life of his middle-class clients by creating an estate-like environment for them to share. The landscape architect he chose for the defining garden part of his Garden City was Fred Barlow Jr., a colleague who'd had an education in regional landscape design of extraordinary breadth and depth at Berkeley, and whose first job out of school was as the head landscape engineer at the legendary Greystone Mansion. Barlow designed more garden apartment landscapes than anyone else in Southern California, and Village Green is his masterwork. The work Johnson oversaw with his team, Merrill, Wilson, Alexander, and Fred Barlow Jr., demonstrates an intentional unity of design, something he particularly valued as a respite from usual chaotic urban jumble. A Pulitzer Prize-winning architectural critic describes this graceful unity like this. Quote, Village Green is one of the great monuments of environmental humanism in the United States. It's an inspired piece of urban design, a masterpiece in its grand design and the refinement of its nuances. Unquote. Early marketing brochures promised that in this village in the city, the car would be quote-unquote tamed so that the residents would feel like they were living at the country club. A quip by Robert Alexander, the youngest architect on the project, who later went on to partner with legendary modernist Richard Neutra, was that Village Green was the apotheosis of the cul-de-sac. The architects on the team that created Village Green were so intrigued with it that they all, including Johnson and his wife, lived here for various lengths of time. To encourage the social life of the new village they had created, they sponsored lectures, dances, concerts, and parties, like this one tonight, in the clubhouse building, and contributed to the community newsletter. In 1941, Johnson personally commissioned our mural. His daughter Constance fell in love with the artist, Rico Lebrun, and the new couple moved into a three-bedroom unit near the West Green with their young son, David. We have David Lebrun to thank for the discovery of a color video, now available on YouTube, that Johnson made in the 40s that shows the building of Village Green and scenes of daily life here. Today, when Reginald Johnson is credited as the architect on a mansion or estate, it fetches a premium at the top tier of the real estate market. At Village Green, we get to live in a whole Reginald Johnson-designed community. In fact, Village Green has actually garnered more awards than any other of Reginald Johnson's projects. Among many others, we've received the American Institute of Architects' prestigious 25-year award, where it joined Rockefeller Center and Frank Lloyd Wright's Taliesin West as the other designees for that year. In its bicentennial celebrations in 1976, the American Institute of Architects selected Village Green as one of the 100 most important architectural achievements in American history. So, in short, we're not only the lucky residents of this historic place, but also the stewards of its masterful design that embodies radical yet timeless ideas and ideals still so relevant in today's world.